Cowboys are 2-0 for the first time since 2008, but the Eagles, not so much. They now have their first 0-2 start since 2007, but what if they don't win next week? Well, only three teams since 1990 who have started 0-3 have reached the postseason. The Chargers in 92, the Lions in 95, and the Bills in 98. We welcome back Eric Allen. You spent seven seasons in Philly. Eric, help us out here. Can the Eagles be fixed?
Yes, of course they can be fixed. It's not going to be an easy fix, but they can be fixed. And I wasn't surprised by the outcome of the game on Sunday. You know, the Dallas Cowboys have been a tremendous team on the road, winning nine in a row, now 10. You know the defense is going to be inspired, Cowboys-wise, going against DeMarco Murray. But the Eagles cannot get out their way. The first game, they had seven or eight penalties offensively. They need to fix that part of the football team. Defensively, the same issues that have been plaguing this team since basically Coach Johnson has been passed away. Mm-hmm. They've always struggled defensively, and they're getting even worse today. You're talking about Maxwell not being able to cover. They've completed anything they wanted in the first game on the right side. It came back this week, and when Wheaton making a great throw in the red zone, a little post route to Terrence. So the same issues defensively that are plaguing this football team, they need to fix that. They don't pressure the quarterback as much as they did last year. But offensively, that's really where the issues are. You get Murray, and you expect Murray to be the downhill runner that we saw last year in Dallas. They're running from a shotgun. That's not what he likes to do. That's not his style. Usually in a shotgun, they have McCoy, a guy who's able to make guys miss, who's slippery. Mm-hmm. That's not Murray's type of running philosophy. They did an outstanding job on Sproles, Dallas Cowboys did, yesterday. They were inspired defense. So this can be fixed, but they first have to fix the point of running the football effectively. They need to find out. And again,
are you going to install the I formation?
No, they don't need to install the I formation. But offensive line-wise, you need to do a better job of sealing, giving him a hole where he can hit the hole and not go from sideline to sideline. And Chip Kelly has been successful everywhere he's been. He's going to be able to change up and make sure that his running back that he got from Dallas is able to help his football team. And the only way he's able to do that is by offensive line and getting some holes where he can run straight up and down the field.
Eric Allen, I need you and folks outside of Skip Bayless. I'm talking about people that played in the NFL to find success for me. I understand where you and I are coming from. But with all due respect, I am getting sick and tired of people telling me that Chip Kelly was successful. Chip Kelly won football games. Chip Kelly never won a national championship.
Right.
Chip Kelly missed the playoffs last year. Chip Kelly is a good football coach. But I do believe that we have the right to sit there and say, or distinguish rather, the difference between being a winner and being good.
Mm-hmm.
There is a difference. Do I think Chip Kelly's a good coach?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the record mandates. Even though they didn't make the playoffs last year, even though they won three of their last, they lost three of their last four regular season games, and they now have lost five of their last six regular season games when you consider the fact that they're 0-2 right now. There's no arguing that in two seasons in Philadelphia, Chip Kelly is 10-6 both seasons.
Yeah.
He ain't 6-10. So we're going to sit there and give him credit where credit is deserved and say he's a good coach. But there's a difference between being good and being a winner.
Mm-hmm.
And I have yet to see Chip Kelly validate that he is a winner. So now we look at the fact that he is no longer in college and he's on the NFL level. And now he's controlling stuff because he's the de facto GM, essentially. And he's calling the shots in terms of getting guys out there, well, or getting guys on your squad. You brought Byron Maxwell into the mix.
Yep.
Paid him over $60 million. I remember you, Eric. I know you could play.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you know when somebody is a bit overrated at that cornerback spot.
For sure.
Can I get an amen on Byron Maxwell?
Oh, you can.
Say it. Say it with me. Say amen.
Amen.
There we go.
Because he is struggling just like the rest of the corners.
All right.
Has struggled in that defensive.
I understand that, but I'm not going to get on Walter Thurman III and other cats. They weren't paid $60 million.
Right,
and
The Saints actually playing pretty good.
That's right. Now you got to skip the problem with your inside linebacker spot. Kiko Alonso, fresh off of two ACL injuries. You decided to bring him in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
He had that left knee bothering him in training camp. Mm-hmm. Yo,
You put him out there anyway, he injured again. Mikal Kendricks, he's now out. He got a problem. He's your inside linebacker. Okay, let's switch to the offensive side. That's just defense.
That's just defense. Who's been struggling for a couple years now.
Yeah. Couple of years now. Not 2 months, 2 years.
Yeah.
So we gonna get that out the way. Now we go to the offensive side of the ball. Evan Mathis is gone because you want to rescind an offer that you made to him to pump up the back end of his contract. You sit there and say, we want to rely on this offensive line. Backups and Gardner and Barbary and these boys, you relying on them. You can't block. Okay. You got a north-south runner. You asking to run east and west. I'm looking at the Eagles offense. And you know what I see?
What do you see?
Softies.
Softies.
That's right. I said, I ain't talking about DeMarco Murray. I'm talking about a relatively soft offense. I'm not talking about Sproles.
Right.
I'm not talking about DeMarco Murray. I'm talking about cumulatively. I'm talking about a unit. This is what I'm talking about.
I'm not calling him soft.
Jordan Matthews can ball.
Yes.
He's an elite number two.
Yeah.
Just a little bit shy of being number one. He need another year or so. Mm. All right? Don't talk to me about Riley Cooper. Damn it, he need to be on the offensive line because all he does is block.
Right.
Remember? That's the first time we learned that the criteria for the wide receiver was blocking instead of catching passes. Remember, we didn't know that until Chip Kelly came along, okay? So I'm just looking at these guys, Aguilar and these boys, they got to prove something.
They do.
First 2 weeks, the Eagles' last point, Eagles were scoreless in five of the first eight quarters of this season with that high-powered offense. You know why? Atlanta punched them in the mouth in the first half. The Cowboys punched them in the mouth
high
in the first three quarters.
You're talking high power. They're not high powered anymore. That's where
I agree with that.
They lost their explosiveness. Okay, 2 years ago, DeSean Jackson, the guy who can break the top off, he was too small, too whatever for you in the locker room.
I get that, Eric.
They need to find a way to get back to running the football.
I want to bring Skip in here. All I'm saying is this. For the first two quarters against Atlanta and the first three quarters against Dallas, they weren't just held scoreless. They got punched in the face.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. That's what I mean. So somebody punches you in the face and you don't respond, that's usually the definition of soft. Now, I could be wrong, Skip, but all I know is whatever hood you want to pick, white, Hispanic, black, whatever, what's known as soft is when somebody punches you in your face or in your mouth and you have no response. That is what the Eagles have been for five quarters.
Check those penalties.
Too many daggone penalties. Yeah. All I'm saying to you is Philadelphia Eagles.
So when you're trying to punch somebody in the mouth and someone's holding you back, okay. That's penalties. All right.
You can say that. Go ahead, Skip.
All right.
Let's hold that thought, Skip. We don't want to cut you off and we need to take a break. So we will revisit your side when we return here on First Take. Keep it here.
Skip knows softies.
I'm with Eric on this one. Now, I can't fix how good Sam Bradford is because I never liked him from the start before that first draft. Okay. Watched him at University of Oklahoma every snap, never loved him. Bad idea to take him number one. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure the running game is fixable, but it can still be decent. And I think Philly can still be pretty good. Even though I'll be the first to admit, I raved about them through the preseason because they were sensational for all four games.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I slightly overrated what that meant to this. But I must say, you brought up the second half at Atlanta. I saw the preseason Eagles in the second half at Atlanta.
Right.
I saw them just rock and roll up and down the field, and they came from 20-3 down at halftime. And if Parkey had made that, what was it, like a 44-yard field goal, they win the game. I'm pretty sure we're talking about the 1-1 Eagles. And in a way, because you got Philly roots, you tend to overreact a little bit like Philly fans overreact, especially after Dallas does that to you.
Yeah.
Really, it's the fourth straight year they've lost at home to Dallas, but it's three straight years Chip Kelly has lost at home to Dallas.
Yeah.
Can I give my Cowboys defense a little bit of credit instead of heaping all the blame on Chip Kelly? Because in three tries at home against my Cowboy defense, Chip Kelly has averaged 13 points a game.
That's phenomenal.
Against every other opponent at home, Chip Kelly has averaged 30 points a game.
Yeah, that's
wow.
Okay, no, what? That says something. Like, they've got your number here. And by the way, not that I'm going to defend Byron Maxwell because you're dead right about everything you've said, but remember, somehow my Cowboys held on to the football for 40 minutes of that game. They dominated the first half in time of possession, so it's 40 minutes to 20 minutes. So that means Byron and company are on the field, and you can certainly speak to this. It's a lot of snaps, man.
Yeah,
I mean, you're just worn out.
You're right. And I think a couple things when you're playing the Cowboys, we always talk about time possession, not important with the Eagles. Yeah. It needs to be important when you play the Cowboys because what they need and want to do in running the football.
Yeah.
And the running game needs to be fixed more like the Patriots when they run LeGarrette Blount. That's the adjustment that Chip Kelly needs to make with the running game as far as DeMarco Murray is concerned. And I agree with you. I think the Cowboys don't get enough credit or didn't get enough credit of doing a good job. Now, I knew they were going to do a good job against Murray because, you know what, you're pumped up, you're excited about playing, you know, that guy, even the punter.
And I don't think he's just,
But the job they did against Sproles was spectacular.
It was pretty good.
Sproles has been successful in any type of situation. They did an outstanding job against Sproles.
So I
think LeGarrette Blount more for the Eagles running game and the defensively, they need to pressure the quarterback more.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, it wasn't just about the Eagles' defense. It wasn't just about the Dallas Cowboys holding on to the football. The Philadelphia Eagles, they went 3 and out on 5 of their first 7 possessions, and the other 2 were 4 and outs. They were doing nothing offensively.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Darren Sproles, keying on him, definitely had something to do with it. But if you have no running game, because Ryan Matthew only gets 1 attempt, and DeMarco Murray's, you got him running east and west instead of north and south, then all of a sudden that allows you to key on other dudes. What makes Dez Bryant special? There are plenty of plays where you know exactly what the Dallas Cowboys are going to do. And Dez Bryant says, so what? What you going to do about it? I'm with Joe Montana last week again. Other than Jerry Rice, tell me a receiver that you wanted to play with. He said Chris Carter, our very own Chris Carter. Why? He said, because from the time we were in the Pro Bowl together, he said, just throw the ball up. I'll get it.
Mm-hmm.
What happens is that who is that person on the Eagles? The fact is, no one is.
Yeah.
So now we get to Chip Kelly. Back to Chip Kelly, because Chip Kelly is the one that made those decisions. He made those modifications. Can it be fixed? Of course it can be fixed, because they have the talent. The question about them is their culture and the toughness that comes with it. Because as individuals, we know individually they are tough. But Eric, you have played on teams where you're tough, and you could pick out a guy on the line, he's tough, and another guy in the secondary, he's tough, and another guy in the offense, and he's tough. But collectively, if you're surrounded by a bunch of dudes where Chip Kelly is breathing in your face about, just do this the way that I say, and do that the way that I say, and we will be perfect. That ain't the man's game that we are accustomed to see.
So how did Chip Kelly, what was his first 2 years record? 10-6, 10-6?
Right.
And then last year they got to 9-3, if I remember, before they cratered?
That's right.
How did they do that?
You also have to remember, because we all know that the man knows football and he can coach. Nobody's saying otherwise. The problem is that those were with other players. He got rid of 9 different dudes, all contributing for other teams right now. He has changed the culture of this team.
The guys you're talking about who will be able to make a play even when the play looks like it's, those guys are gone.
They're
a guy who can make something out of nothing.
They're not tough guys. They're just talented guys.
I'm sorry, y'all finally hearing me now?
I'm talking about talent, man. I'm saying they're talented guys. They ain't tough.
Let's leave it there.
You ain't tough, what are you?
I'm talented.
You ain't tough, what are you?
You're not in the league.
You're soft.
Gotta be a rough rider. It's football. It's gotta be a rough rider. This ain't tennis.
We got to put flags on the quarterback, though.
Yeah.
Eric, thank you so much for being with
us.
This was fun. We appreciate you. Enjoy the games tonight.
Yes,
the game.
Sure.
Week 2 was a role reversal of sorts for the 1 and 2 picks. I'm confused, gentlemen. Need you to help me out. Mm. So what did week 2 tell us about Mariota and Winston? They'll break that down coming up.